Berkeley's annual Juneteenth Festival returns this year along a five-block stretch on Adeline Street between Ashby and Alcatraz Streets in South Berkeley. The festival will kick off its 26-year celebration on Sunday, June 23rd, from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m., and will feature arts, crafts, music, cultural events, ethnic foods, and a kid zone. Ashby BART is the easiest access to the event. The festival benefits the activities of the Berkeley Juneteenth Association. For more information about the festival, call 510-655-8008.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is a minute past 1 o'clock. Up next, Terra Verde.
From the Amazon basin, from the magnificent redwoods of California to the icy majesty of the Arctic, life on Earth faces an unprecedented threat from careless development. Join Terra Verde over lunch today to find out about the unfolding future of the planet.
Welcome to Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show. I'm your host, Michelle Chan. Well, the theme of today's show on Terra Verde, aha moments. We have all had them, a particular insight or experience that, if we're open to it, can transform us, the way we relate with others, and our relationship with our environment as well. In the next half hour, we'll hear from three individuals, Jason Rainey, Aisha Clote, whose aha moments completely changed the way they approach their environment in their local communities and their idea of themselves. And at the end of the show, we'll also talk with Jay Golden to discuss how being open to and sharing our aha moments can be transformational, from the work we choose to do to the way we discuss politics over the Thanksgiving kitchen table. So let's start with Jason Rainey. He is currently the executive director of International Rivers, an international organization working to defend rivers and people against harmful big dams. Now, International Rivers was recently recognized with a MacArthur Award for creative and effective institutions. But before Jason became head of an award-winning institution, there was just Jason, a river, and an aha moment. Jason Rainey.
This aha moment, this story begins on the first moon of January in 2006, on a very crisp January on the South Yuba River. It occurs about 8 years after the aha moment I look to share next week. I'm on the river with my less than one-year-old daughter strapped in a harness around my chest. I'm standing there being smudged by a Maidu woman with sage and the fragrance and that cool air enveloping me and my daughter. And from that bridge, we begin a procession to walk down to the banks of the South Yuba River. And I'm brought here because of a mentor and a teacher, a man named Bill, who has brought a salmon ceremony down from the Pacific Northwest. An indigenous salmon ceremony in which he's been empowered to share with other communities. He's shared and conducted this ceremony on creeks in Marin, and after 70 years brought coho salmon back to Blue Line Creek, for example. And so I've engaged Bill in wanting to go deeper in what it means for me to be home, because I am in my home watershed. I've returned there as the director of the South Yuba River Citizens League, and I'm about a little less than a year into that tenureship, knowing that I really and keenly want to root my environmental work, my watershed restoration, into the indigenous wisdom and traditions of this place, this epicenter of California's gold rush. As a small group of people assemble by the riverside under a massive elder madrone tree, a mother madrone, right where Spring Creek cascades into the South Yuba Canyon, Bill begins the ceremony. And through the burning of cedar, through the prayers and songs, and through this ceremony that's brought down from the far north, he invites my daughter into the ceremony and gives her a basket of the salmon medicine. We are about, at this point, 20 miles upstream from the dam, Engelbreit Dam, which is the barrier to salmon. And this work that we're doing is the beginning of spirit healing work, trying to call the salmon back home, just as I'm trying to call myself to be greater rooted to home. My daughter has an opportunity to go to Spring Creek. I lean her over the creek as she's in this harness all bundled up in her January warm clothes, and she tosses this cedar medicine mixed with other herbs, the salmon medicine, into the creek so that it may flow downstream, recognizing the importance of the watershed, the importance of the slogan we often say about we all live downstream, and recognizing that whatever we do up in the headwaters, the source waters, accrues downstream, be it beneficial or otherwise. So we're sending that good medicine down there, and we're gathering. And the intensity of this moment is sparked because this is the first time I've actually met the Maidu leadership, and it's Bill that's brought the kind of traditional environmental community or the contemporary environmental community together around this ceremony, and he's invited in participation by the Maidu, who have begun to reorganize and assert their leadership after a 150-year absence and after a period of great pain. As we're standing on the bridge, ceremony completed, I'm talking with the tribal chairman, Don Ryberg, of the Maidu. And we're getting to know each other on this bridge. And he says to me, you know, this was a really great ceremony, but there's only one problem. The salmon of the Yuba River speak Maidu. And so I think I have an uncle. Why don't I get back to you to see if I can't bring back the Maidu ceremony to this river? Well, flash forward to the very next October, about 9 months later, and with a community of hundreds, and after a lot of deep, deep work with the leadership of the Maidu, we've been invited to come together on the banks of the Yuba River and conduct a Maidu salmon ceremony with the same political element of spearing a salmon and taking that salmon from below the dam and carrying it on a spirit run above the dam so that that medicine and energy can float down and do what it will to that dam wall. And this is a tradition that started in 2006 in October, and next year will be the 8th year that we have all come together, indigenous Maidu people, the broader local community, and also indigenous and other representatives from throughout the world, to honor our waters, to be rooted in deep ceremony, and to recognize that the work of watershed restoration begins with healing, and that that healing must come through a recognition of the deep historical wounds and the personal wounds coming together to heal the watershed. And one of those terms is Uma Tatodum, which in Maidu means coming together, we work better together.
Mm-hmm. This is Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show. I'm Michelle Chan, your host, and you've been listening to the voice of Jason Rainey of International Rivers. Today on Terra Verde, we're talking about aha moments, these moments of insight or experience that change the way we view the environment, we view our own lives, and we view others. Next, we're pleased to hear from Aisha Cote. She's the author of a book, Beyond Fear, 12 Spiritual Keys to Racial Healing, and also co-founded an Oakland-based organization that helps transform urban environments and communities through art and leadership development. And her aha moment also had a profound impact on her life and the future of the work she does.
It is such a pleasure to be here, and I just want to really just say hello to all of my friends out in KPFA land. My really deep moment began many, many years ago, and I began to work with attitudinal healing as a tool for healing my own mind. Because it is based on the belief that we really, there's nothing out there, that within me is the entire planet. Everything exists within me. But also I realized that, you know, as a Black American, there's a lot of division, but I didn't really see myself as being a part of the whole American dream. And I'm married to, I wish Kokomon was here because he would be drumming and singing. And I think my aha moment really, really began in Ghana, West Africa. But I had spent a lot of time working on myself here and really believing that and knowing and working with the principles of attitudinal healing, that the essence of our being is love, and health is inner peace, and healing is letting go of fear, and now is the only time there is, and looking at ways that I could connect with all of humanity, and not really dealing deeply with the diversity, just moving more closely with looking at how can we all work together. And I was in Ghana, and my first trip to Ghana, it was absolutely amazing. The plane landed, it was like in 1992, everybody was like at the airport greeting me, and they didn't know me, they were just greeting everyone. And saying, Akwaba, welcome, a lot of smiles, and it was really, really beautiful. We had planned our whole trip, and I was going to go to the Door of No Return, which is the slave castle, and I was going to be staying with Kokomon's family, and we had a whole trip all planned out, and it was absolutely amazing. The first two or three days in the family compound, I met this wonderful little boy. His name was Atukwe, and Atukwe and I fell in love immediately. And Kokomon also had a brother there visiting from Europe with his white European wife. And so as we played with the little boy, the next day his mother came over. And when his mother came over, she came straight up to me. She said, I came to meet you. Atukwe was here, and he said there were two white women in the compound. One had black skin, and the other one had white skin. And I immediately got very, very angry. I wasn't thinking about being peaceful inside at all. I began to explain the horrors of what happens in this country and how black people are treated and how I'm not a white woman. And I spent the rest of the month talking about that. And whoever I met, I began to tell them. And then I went to the slave dungeon. And going to the slave dungeon, we were walking, and there were two Dutch guys there. And as we walked into the castle, which they called it a castle, it was really a slave dungeon, there was a church with a steeple on it, and you looked up, it was the Psalms 27 that said, for God is my Savior and my salvation, whom shall I fear? And then as you walk down into the entrance for the slaves, you're walking on 12 inches of petrified human flesh. And I was absolutely overcome with grief and anguish, and Kokomon's spiritual leader, Ganaba, tried to really prepare me. But at that time, I was an attitudinal healing queen. I knew everything. And as Americans, when we go somewhere, we know everything. No one can tell us. We're there to help them. No one can tell us anything. And so I was just a wreck. And I didn't realize what I was getting myself into. And as I came out, I don't think the two Dutch guys realized I wasn't the same person that went in. Smoke was coming from my head. My eyes was red. Smoke was coming from my ears. I was a very angry woman. And they began to explain how beautiful the castle was. And I immediately launched toward them as I was saying, how can you? And I was going to really, it was going to be an attitudinal killing. I was reaching for their necks, and the tour guide grabbed me, and the tour guide grabbed them and rushed them out. And I really, at that moment, began to see that, oh, my God, I was going to after them. And I've never had a fight in all my life, even as a child. I never fought anyone. And I began to think, oh, my God. And when the tour guide came back, I looked at him. I said, I would not have hurt them. He said, Madame, I could not take a chance. the last African-American woman that came through here, she bit a man's ear off. People don't understand that this is a gravesite. There's a lot of grief here. And sometimes they forget and people don't understand. So I could not take a chance. So I left the slave dungeon, and my trip, my first trip to Africa was very, very strange, but also very enlightening. Because my next adventure was I went to Kokomon's family. They enthroned and dethroned chiefs. So I went into one of, we were going to a chief, it was August. This is the time when all the high rituals are happening. And I, at that time, I had dreadlocks, long, long dreadlocks. So I got to the, we got to the chief's house, and the chief linguist was standing at the door, at the front door of the chief house. And as I was beginning to walk in, he said, ma'am, you can't go through the front. You have to go through the back. I grew up in Louisiana, and I was thinking, me? Go to the back door? And it's Africa? What is going on? So I immediately began to scream all of my attitudinal healing out of the window. I was no longer peaceful inside. I was a wreck. And so he said, okay, ma'am, calm down, calm down. He said, I'm not trying to send you to the back door. I'm telling you that because the deities that we have called down at this time, your hair, they will see you as one of them and they will enter you. And I don't think you will ever be the same. That's why I'm asking you to go to the other door. Please, I apologize. And I said, okay, thank you. I'll go to the other door. Because I didn't want a deity to enter me. And then, as I was on the plane coming back home, I began to think about Atuke. And I really realized this little boy, 4 years old, wasn't looking at me. He was looking at my essence, my European essence. He just called it what it was. He wasn't trying to insult me. He was just saying there was a white woman with black skin in the house. And then as I came back to the country and I realized, I thought about our work, and this was in 1992, and I said, we really have to do something about racism. And really begin to look at, as Americans, we have work to do. Most of us think like Sarah Palin. We think about Africa as a country. And we also don't understand that it is a continent. And we don't see how we're all, our commonality and the essence of what it means and how we are as Americans. Wherever we go, we take that essence with us. And we have to do this work of healing because we impact the nation. We impact the world. We impact everyone. So from there, about maybe around 1995, John Denver, who was doing work, his symposiums on the environment, called us and said he would like to have us do a presentation on racism and the environment. Because many times, as Westerners, we take our garbage and we dump it on indigenous people to Africa. So we really have to start looking at the way that we see people of color and how we can begin to heal and how we can begin to do our work. And so that was an aha moment for me. I began to really wrap myself around this and really begin to also see how Kokomon and I, he's from Ghana. I grew up in Louisiana. My forefathers have been here for over 500 years. They came on the slave ships, but they are Americans. And also, another really, really aha moment was I went to a really small village the next year in Ghana. So when we went to the village, there was a healer there. And so when I went to the healer, I asked the healer, I said, why didn't you guys come and get us? And he looked at me. He said, ma'am, I must pour libation. He said, I'm not pouring libation to you. I'm pouring libation to the unseen ancestors that I see with you. He said, I see on this side a red man. I see on this side a white man. And I see on, and the, right in the center, I see a black man. Those are all the people that are on your DNA. He didn't say DNA. He said, those are all your ancestors. And I also began to really think about that. And that was an aha moment. And I realized I have so much work to do on myself. I will be working on myself for the next 100 years just to sort out how we do our work in this country that we are so wealthy. And that's why we really, really put energy into serving our young people to make sure our young people understand the work of healing from within. And attitudinal healing is the process of learning to let go of fearful experiences about one's life. And that is the work. And I have many aha moments.
This is Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show. I'm Michelle Chan, your host, and you've been listening to the voice of Aisha Cloete of the Oakland-based organization Attitudinal Healing, which helps transform urban environments and communities through art and leadership development. So this brings us to our last guest, Jay Golden. He's of Waking Star, which actually works with people to tell their own stories as a path to personal and environmental change. Jay, how did you get started in all this?
Well, I was standing on the side of a road in southern Argentina on a long trip from the south to the north. It took about 8 months. This was at the beginning. And I was hitchhiking because that was the way that I liked to travel back then, because I could connect with the culture and also it was free. But between the hitchhiking, you actually do a lot of standing and a lot of thumb out looking at the road, waiting for cars and waiting for cars and waiting for cars. In this place, in the southern Pampa, the wind blows very strongly and the grass moves back and forth. And as I was standing in that wind, I noticed something off to the side. I noticed there was something out in the field that was coming towards me, and I thought, what is that? I looked right at it, and I still couldn't understand. It looked like a big white ghost running towards me. And I said, what is that? I look again, and I couldn't still figure out what it was. It was hopping. And then I realized it was actually a plastic bag. And I kind of laughed to myself, and I couldn't tell anybody the story because I was just standing there by myself for hours on end. But after that, I noticed another bag running towards me, hopping, kind of like a Pillsbury Doughboy hopping across the field. And it happened again and again. And it was all of these bags that were coming from the north heading to the south. And it really, that really sat with me the whole trip. And I realized as I was actually, something similar happened when I was in southern or northern Colombia, where I ended up on an island very nearby, about 3 miles from Cartagena, which is one of the most beautiful white beaches you'll ever see. And 3 miles away from there, in a tiny little island, was a beach that was absolutely covered with styrofoam. And I thought back, as I was standing on this beach covered in styrofoam, I thought back to that moment with the plastic bags, and I realized, coming from the north is this incredible innovation and this incredible capacity to design amazing things heading towards the south. And yet, are we offering the solutions to those amazing innovations? Are we bringing along with that the ways of handling and dealing with those, really what becomes, can become a problem? That's something that comes from really a miracle. And so from that, I realized that that's part of my work, is to be able to connect these challenges with solutions. And when I moved back to San Francisco in 95, I started getting involved in media, worked in internet stuff, teaching, doing educational websites and entertainment websites, and then eventually videos that traveled all around the world, educating people on how and organic foods and alternative energies and social justice issues. And bit by bit, as the media evolved, I realized, I kind of had another realization, which was that it's not just the videos that travel around that give us insight. It's actually those stories that we share with one another, those person-to-person stories that share our own journeys and our own key insights, that is a media, it's a form of like the original social media that's not given nearly enough credence. And that was the spark that began Waking Star.
Right. And Waking Star is actually a consulting firm that you run. And it really is about injecting sort of story and personal story back into sort of the way the quote unquote mainstream environmental movement certainly ends up sort of telling the environmental story, which is actually not very inspiring.
Yeah, a lot of times with environmental stories, you kind of find you're stuck in problems. It's just people, the more studied people become, it seems the more dour they become also. And oftentimes it seems to be a tool to show how bad things can possibly get and feature them in order to illuminate problems and sometimes, frankly, to raise money or create, you know, to scare people. And I mean, not just scare people from an organizational or a cultural standpoint, but, you know, to shock them into some sort of awareness at the Thanksgiving table, as you brought up. The problem with just focusing on problems is they kind of get stuck and they're not really stories. In fact, a story is a problem recounted in an interesting way that makes us care. It's something that brings us from a problem into a solution or a vision for how we, at least as individuals, have learned something and have changed our lives.
Right. Mm-hmm. And in fact, coming up very soon at the Brower Center in Berkeley, you're going to be running an event and really geared towards the community as well as the, you know, environmentalists or self-identified environmentalists about how to bring story into our work, both in terms of on the personal as well as the movement level. So in the last minutes that we have, can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so next week on Thursday, the 20th of June at 6:30 at the David Brower Center at the Goldman Theater there, we're going to gather people together, have some featured storytellers. A couple of Aisha and Jason are actually going to tell a couple of slightly different stories than they told today. But the point of it, and several other folks that have really gone through this amazing transformation, Andy Rubin, who started sustainability at Walmart, but then realized that their real sustainability is what we find and share in our garages, this incredible resource that we already have. And Maya Koringle, who went from this venture capitalist world to realizing that social impact investing and microfinance and support on the ground is actually a critical opportunity to use our resources. And the experience is something that's really about featured stories, but really it's about sparking a framework for the audience to connect with their own stories. And that's the combination that we're going to do in addition to serving some tea and chocolate.
Great. So that's going to be this coming Thursday at 6:30 at the David Brower Center in downtown Berkeley. It's an environmental storytelling event. Hope that the stories that you heard today piqued a little bit of your interest. That's all the time we have. Thank you so much, Jason, Aisha, and Jay, for joining us. And to Erica Bridgman, our engineer. You can listen to archives of this show and others on kpfa.org, and we hope to join you next week.
You are invited to join us for Mount Tam Jam, a benefit for the mountain, on Saturday, June 22nd from 12 to 7 p.m. for a day of great music and merriment a bit closer to the clouds. It wants a celebration of and a benefit for Mount Tamalpais State Park. In the wake of California's state park's budget crisis, Mount Tam Jam features performances by New Orleans funk masters Galactic, quirky and eclectic alt rockers Cake, roots blues and world music icon Taj Mahal, Nashville soul powerhouse Mike Ferris, and more. The concert's aim is to raise funding for sorely needed resources for the mountain. From ranger and maintenance personnel to equipment for trail and bridge restoration and improved search and rescue response. Held high atop the mountain in a natural amphitheater with stunning views of San Francisco Bay, Mount Tam Jam is some good D-doing for a special place in the neighborhood. Visit www.tamjam.org.